good morning.
All right, I'm actually excited for this show a little bit because they're going to talk about the AMD stuff that I want for my PC upgrade. So hopefully they give some details on Navi a bit.
We're so happy you're here today. We have a great show for you lined up. We got 30 games that we're going to be showing off. 30.
Some of them less
will be updates to existing franchises and titles. Others will be exclusive world first looks. Y'all ready?
Not bad. 30 games.
Well, I first want to thank our sponsors for helping make this event possible. Without their support,
enjoy,
this
guys.
Event
I'm gonna
would not
go ahead and start tweeting
so
some stuff.
Thank you so much. Thanks to you for coming out. It's 10 a.m. in Los Angeles. Happy Monday, everyone. Best day of the week. Hello to all of you up in the balcony. And of course, thanks to you tuning in live from all over the internet, YouTube, Twitch, Twitter, Facebook, wherever you're tuning in from, welcome. We're happy to have you. My name is Day 9. I'm one of your hosts for this event. Joining me is the fantastic Frankie Ward.
Hello. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you, Sean. Hello, everyone. Now, for you guys at home, for the first time, whatever platform you're watching on, we are going to be pulling your clever comments. Just remember that I said clever comments from Twitch, Twitter, YouTube, and Facebook throughout the show, making you famous on the internet, on the screen. We're going to be sharing them live. And one of the things we're especially looking for are your questions for the Borderlands 3 team, because Sean, you've got a mission to put their questions to the developers later.
That's right. Midway through this show, I'm going to be asking those questions to the creative director of Borderlands 3. Use hashtag PC Gaming Show, and we'll read them live. Until then, let's start the PC Gaming Show with our very first title from UK developer Rebellion. Several years ago, they announced that they were working on the follow-up to Evil Genius, a real-time evil lair simulator.
And now, Rebellion is ready to reveal its nefarious vision for the project. So, PC Gaming Show, who's ready to stroke a cat menacingly?
I am.
Here is the world exclusive reveal for Evil Genius 2 World Domination.
Is this a Minions game? Oh, that's that one game. Oh, the one with the facilities and stuff. I haven't seen this game in a long time, I think. Damn, I forgot the name of it though. Ready to go. Pretty sure this is that one game where you're basically like Theme Hospital or those like Evil Genius 2. There we go. I thought part two already came out though. I thought this would be like another one.
Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines 2 is the successor to one of the most beloved RPGs ever. And with me to talk about it, I have Brian Mitsoda and Kara Ellison from Hardsuit Labs. Now, Brian, you were a writer on the very first game, so what does it mean for you to finally get to work on the sequel?
It means that a lot of people have very high expectations, and we have to meet those.
Well, let's take a look at whether you are going to meet them, because we are going to take a look at the world's first gameplay footage.
I guess I have to be the one to tell you. You're dead. You're obviously new to this whole existence, but truth is, most of you types won't even make it a whole year.
What's this?
We have one rule. You don't break the masquerade.
Oh, that masquerade thing. The one with the vampires. All right.
The city. We're all fighting over scraps here.
Yo, I've heard so much good things about the first one.
Having fun yet?
Vampire the Masquerade. Bloodlines 2. Hells yeah. Alright, early next year. Cool, cool.
Guys, I was hoping this year, though. What does it mean to be a vampire in this world?
It's a game with a lot of choices.
What it is, it's kind of a darker version of
think
our world.
Like Dishonored, but a little bit better storyline.
Need to keep their presence secret from humanity. So the vampires are kind of staying hidden in the shadows while also needing to feed on human beings and kind of manipulating us in order to get blood.
We're talking about feeding on human beings. I'm getting flashbacks to last year's show. Karara, it's not just a case, though, of sucking blood and filling up your health meter, is it? Actually, different types of blood do different things.
That's right. So we have the resonance system, which means that
can I vote? I don't even
vampires,
know what any of these races are, though.
See the emotional resonance of human beings.
I know a lot of people are going to be Malkavian, I bet.
Desire,
that sounds pretty cool.
And then they can feed on those people to feel the same things as human beings do, to feel more kind of alive. And that can give you extra boost in the game.
And there were some really interesting characters in that trailer as well. What kind of relationships are we going to be forming with them as the player?
Well, very fragile. Very volatile relationships, very mature relationships, so it's going to be a fun time.
And one thing that was really intriguing to me when I was learning about this game is you don't just get bitten and turn into Nosferatu, Dracula, or Brad Pitt. And to be honest, I think
Brad Pitt
into the game, because then I'm definitely playing it. You actually have to adjust to your environment to becoming a vampire, Zara.
That's right. So essentially, in the game, when you were made as a vampire, a sort of very young vampire, a lot of other vampires are made at the same time in this thing called the mass embrace. And that means that essentially they're having a less lucky time than you in the world. You're having a relatively good time compared to them because they don't know what they're doing. They're going through vampire puberty on their own. And you might have a family, you might have a wife and children, and you are morally objecting to drinking blood to survive.
Have a waifu?
So I have a less good time, let's say, than the player is having. So you can find them throughout the world as well.
And Brian, the first game came out in 2004. You've been waiting 15 years for this. Any pressure?
Yeah, tons of pressure. But yeah, we're going to make it worth it.
Well, you know what? I think there are people around the world watching this, and of course the audience here, and they all can't wait to play this game. Can you wait, guys? Okay. So I think you've convinced everyone here now. When are we going to be able to play the game?
We're going Q1 next year.
Fantastic. And when can we learn more?
Bloodlines2.com.
Thank you so much, Brian and Kara. Good luck. Give it up, guys.
Awkward little interview, I guess.
Now,
but,
have you ever wanted to play Dwarf Fortress in space? Starmancer is a space station sim from Omnux Games and Chucklefish. After a catastrophe on Earth, humanity has launched a desperate attempt to find refuge among the stars. Your task is to manage a colony capable of sustaining life, crafting components, controlling colonists, and sending out crews to mine asteroids. But when you're living in space, there can be big consequences for even the smallest mistakes. Let's take a look at the brand new gameplay for Starmancer.
Chucklefish. Cute little icon. Oh man, I like this. It's gonna be like an SCOM game. Oh, and it's pixelated? Oh, shit! Look at that. Some kind of space colony. You know that guy's up to no good. look at his fucking face, bro. He's got a crack in his head. Super somber, though. Starmancer. I'll check that game out.
Our next guests both started as modders, and now they each independently run their own studio. Let's welcome to the stage, from Tripwire, John Gibson, and from Torn Banner, Steve Piggott.
Hey, Sean.
Now I understand. Both of you started as modders, working independently, running your own studios. Talk to me about the collaboration that you started together.
Yeah, Steve. So we've known the Torn Banner guys for a long time, even giving them some advice when they were modders going commercial, helping them not make the mistakes that we made. And we've been friends, and we've always wanted to work together. And now we've sort of formed this independent, former mod team, professional super group to get an awesome game out to fans.
Yeah, and for us, this is a dream partnership as well. We've always been really close with Tripwire, and we really respect their games. We see them as one of the few studios that's bringing true innovation to the FPS genre, and that's what we're all about as well.
Well, let's take a look at this upcoming collaboration between Torn Banner and Tripwire.
It's gonna be another chivalry game.
You go first. It's your chicken.
Sounds like it. Or is chivalry 2 not a thing yet? Joss. Feel the blow to the face. I'm beheading everybody in this game. There's no other way to die. Not stabbing anybody. You gotta behead them.
I'm unarmed.
Yep, there you go. Exactly what I'm gonna do.
Oh, talk to me about Chivalry 2, Steve.
Well, Chivalry 2 is about bringing players into their favorite medieval movie battle scenes. And our flagship game mode, Team Objective, does that by having players complete medieval objectives like sieging castles, raiding villages, and
you're not just going and standing in an area and then a bar fills up. You're, like you said, burning houses, killing peasants, you know.
Yeah.
Playing as peasants, getting killed.
It's really about letting the player experience every iconic moment of the era. And on top of that, this time around, we've increased the player count scale to about 2.5 times what the previous game was, the 64 players. And on top of that increased scale, we've added horses, which really allows us to add a lot of drama to the game and bring experiences like the Battle of the Bastards.
Is there a question on what else to pick other than
Don't worry,
Knight?
We'll ignore the last season. Just Battle of the Bastards
Maybe
is going to be in the game.
Yes.
All right, so I want to ask about the swordplay element to Chivalry 2. I mean, I know it's a really critical element.
Yeah, and this time around, we've completely revamped. I mean, we really view what we're doing here as bringing a true sequel in every sense.
Yeah.
We've attempted to completely revamp the combat, movement, and animation systems so that every swing, every action in the combat feels readable and fair and also has the satisfaction of the weight that you would expect when two medieval knights in full armor are clashing.
Yeah, and it's very, very fluid.
If they're
going to
talk after every game and there's 30 games, it's going to be a long show.
The pace is so much quicker. It was what I really
I'm going to go get a drink, guys. I'll be right back.
Yeah, and I wanted to ask about the fluidity, because in a lot of melee combat games, you hit a button and there's like a full animation swing and then you sort of reset. So it's kind of these discrete, chunky times. I understand that in Chivalry 2, the swordplay operates differently than that.
Yeah, we kind of think of it like when you're swimming, where you're kind of constantly using both arms at the same time. And a core part of our focus this time around has been making it so that players can fight multiple opponents at the same time.
Like one-on-three, one-on-four situations?
Exactly, because that's fundamentally part of the becoming the ultimate warrior fantasy and achieving glory on the battlefield.
Well, I mean, I do have to ask, we're talking about swordplay and mastery, but the original chivalry is, I mean, it's kind of like silly fun. Like, how do you balance the mastery with the fun element?
Yeah, our goal has always been to make it so that players can take the game as seriously as they want to and also as silly as they want to. We know that probably about half our audience plays the game drunk, and we love that.
At least half.
Yeah.
That's an important metric to track.
I mean, that's how you fought back in the day, man. Oh, manly and stuff.
And the over-the-top voiceovers and the drunk role-playing opportunities.
Hells yeah.
I mean, the game is genuinely hilarious. As an example, you can beat a man with a chicken while quoting Shakespeare.
Like, so like picking up a chicken as a
weapon.
Yeah,
physically
that's a mechanic.
Clubbing him to death with
well,
a
that's
chicken.
Excellent. Well, I mean, I have to ask, when can people get their hands on Chivalry 2?
So Chivalry 2 is coming out early 2020, and it's coming first to the Epic Games Store.
Oh, look forward to checking it out in early 2020. Gentlemen, John Gibson and Steve Piggott with Chivalry 2. Thank you so much.
Epic.
We are just
getting
started here at the PC Gaming Show. Let's take a look at what's coming up next.
Isn't this show sponsored by Epic? Yeah. Makes sense now.
Coming up, build a world for wildlife in Planet Zoo.
Planet Zoo,
from the creators
yeah.
of Darksiders,
I want to get my hands on that.
Baldur's Gate 3, and more trailers, interviews, and gameplay footage.
Cthulhu's back, motherfuckers. Oh, I've seen a trailer of this before. Something like this one, I think. Yeah. Something to do about how society works nowadays, or something like how everybody's lost into technology or something.
A brand new trailer for Mosaic, a dark and atmospheric adventure game coming later this year from developer Killbyte and publisher Raw Fury. So how are you guys enjoying it so far? There's been some swords, some space stations, vampire puberty. We're listening to your reactions to the PC Gaming Show throughout the entire broadcast, no matter what platform you're watching and ranting on, so keep them coming. Our next game is a ghost-themed multiplayer hide-and-seek game inspired by a popular mod. Charge up your proton packs and get ready for Midnight Ghost Hunt.
When the night falls, there's only you and me.
Oh, is this like a hide and seek kind of game or something?
You can count on me.
Like the Ghostbusters are coming in looking for the ghost, and you play the ghost trying to hide. Yo. That's kind of cool.
So just tell me, where are you?
I wonder if it's a 4v1 kind of game.
I got a big surprise for
oh
you.
Shit, get him! That's awesome. Yo, how many ways to kill the Ghostbusters are there?
I got a big surprise.
That's interesting. Funny that the Ghostbusters franchise never thought of that. That's fucking amazing. No pain, just liquor. That's how you got through the pain, man.
Joining me on the stage to talk about Midnight Ghost Hunt.
Get that slice and yeah, it just feels like a normal baby, right?
Creative director, programmer, designer,
Sam Lone. Destiny. Dude.
Thank you for having me.
Dude.
Sam, please tell us what is going on in
there. Yeah, you're a little
What is Midnight Ghost Hunt all about?
So
She's
Midnight Ghost
cute.
Hunt is a multiplayer ghost hunting
the,
hide-and-seek
the speaker?
Game. You can play as either as ghosts or ghost hunters, like a 4v4 format.
I see.
The ghosts can hide inside average everyday objects around the haunted house. The goal is to look like harmless furniture.
Yeah, there's a bit of delay.
Inside,
I'm not on
they're
the
not so harmless ghosts as you saw.
On NVIDIA.
Yeah, and if I'm understanding correctly,
so it doesn't
it's
have
not
that.
About
that quickness that they have with the technology.
To try to assault and take out a hunter, it's actually, you would
it's probably
do that,
like
so that
maybe a 5 10 second delay maybe?
Exactly, so the main objective of the ghosts is to try to stay hidden as long as they can until the time runs out, until the clock strikes midnight. Midnight being kind of the hour of the
yeah.
ghosts, basically. They can fight back if they like, but in general, you know, they want to try to hide. But if there's a hunter kind of off by himself, he can quickly just hit him in the back of the head and knock him out real quick, and he has less hunters to deal with at that point.
I see. Well, what's the identity of the hunters? I mean, when seeing furniture flying all over the place, what are the hunters doing?
So the hunters, it kind of can be divided into two different segments. The first part of the game
oh,
is
man,
kind of almost like a detective
go,
game because they're sort of trying to figure out where the ghosts are hiding because it's not really you know, obvious at first glance. So they've got gadgets like a footprint tracker, they've got like a radar like you saw, to try to narrow down where in the haunted house these ghosts are hiding, basically. As soon as the first ghost is found,
yeah.
though, it starts getting a bit more chaotic. People, there's ragdolls flying everywhere, and they have that cannon to really try to smash the ghosts into pieces. So those are kind of the two aspects of the ghosts.
I see. Well, talk to me a little bit about the inspiration for Midnight Ghost Hunt. I understand it's based on a Gary's mod called Prop Hunt.
Right. So that's definitely a big inspiration, but the big twist for us is that the props fight back. You saw the furniture, they hurl themselves
yeah.
at you, they knock you out, they send you flying. So it kind of almost becomes like this action hide-and-seek sort of mashup. You have a reason to be a little bit afraid of the things that you're hunting. So that changes
yeah.
up the dynamic a good amount, I think.
And I want to ask about when the clock strikes midnight. We saw the very spooky
folding
red
open now.
Color
have
pop
you
up. We didn't see
seen a ghost?
What happens then? What's going on then?
So midnight, if even one ghost survives
right,
4 minutes
back,
into the match, then you hear this ominous grandfather.
Is there any
clock
emergency
mask?
You gotta go anywhere?
All the lights will actually flicker out. It'll get really dark and scary, and all of the ghosts that were destroyed actually return as vengeful spirits. They're a lot more powerful than before, and they glow a very brilliant red. So at this point, the tables have turned. The hunters are now the hunted, and they just need to try
yeah.
to work together to stay alive long enough for their evac to come, which is another 4 minutes or so. Usually
wow.
the ghosts win when it gets to midnight.
Are you talking about like 90%
yeah,
of the time?
I imagine.
Yeah,
like
usually because the ghosts are so overpowered at midnight.
Right.
The hunters are doing whatever they can to try to prevent midnight from even occurring by destroying all
right,
of the
right.
ghosts and clearing the house.
Well, awesome. When can people get the chance to try out Midnight Ghost Hunt?
So we'll be running an alpha event later in
the
summer.
I hope.
You can sign up at midnightghosthunt.com. I'd also like to give a shout out to our Discord.
That's a good game to play before all the rush of games come out for
the
holidays.
Later in the summer, we'll be giving out keys on our Discord as well as on our main website.
Well, wonderful.
Everything's good. Good, man.
Sam Malone from Vaulted Sky Games. For our next title, we got Frankie up in the balcony, and if I understand correctly, Frankie, this is a sequel.
You do understand correctly, Sean, yes.
It's
a big sequel to a small indie game. Unexplored 2 is a procedural adventure, a roguelite that challenges you to fight, to be clever, and to solve its mysteries. Explore
this your girl, Jay?
World, engage with
this
its
your girl?
And befriend its people.
You crushing on her,
Search
bro?
Search for magic lakes and ancient statues until you die. And die again. This is Unexplored 2.
Big Sugar. Ah, Jay. This is cool. Boys just shanked you and left you to die, bro.
Ah.
Yo, is he walking on water? This is the story of Jesus, bro. Damn, times were hard back in Jesus' time. Damn, he could just stand on it and shit. Get nothing. Jay's gonna get all gushy now every time you see her.
One of the biggest bang for your buck that you can get when building a new rig is investing in a new monitor. And here to talk about a groundbreaking new display is Samsung's Dean Delcero. Welcome, Dean. What you got for us?
Samsung.
C27
R2. Oh, I was like, what are they gonna announce in the gaming show for PC? Get it now. Hey, somebody's got to pay the bills for this show, you know? Might as well let the hardware people start paying the bills, you know? Oh, look at your little heart emote. It was love at first sight. Just not a fan of Samsung products anymore, man.
Dean, we've seen the video.
I feel like they've lost a little bit of their quality.
Talk to me about those juicy features and specs.
So it's a 240 hertz curved gaming panel. We believe it's a world first. So you have lag-free and tear-free performance. And we think that the curve, it's 1500 art radius, is going to be a very immersive experience you wouldn't get from a traditional flat panel.
And I wanted to ask a little bit about some of the color specs.
Sure, it's a 3,000-to-1 contrast ratio, so you get those deeper blacks, brighter whites. Right. Hopefully, you'll see your
man. Could you imagine forgetting your actual notes on the merchandise?
On the screen first as well. G-Sync compatible monitor, so we're super.
You gotta like
about
study
that.
For well, a week so you don't fucking fuck up on stage.
Variety of games here. What are the types of games that you would expect that 240 hertz refresh rate and the G-Sync to work well with?
Sure. So we think everybody's gonna appreciate the speed and the performance, but ultimately, esports first-person shooters are really gonna benefit.
Right. Well, of course, I have to ask, not just when is it available, but what type of cost are we talking?
Sure. So it'll be available in mid-July for under $400.
That would be so embarrassing, man.
So it expands our gaming lineup to 8 miles. Yeah.
Because when you said 400, I mean, that's the 27-inch is the $400 mark. Wow.
Yeah, so our gaming lineup will be expanded to 8 models, ranging from 24 all the way up to a 49-inch dual QHD. Check out samsung.com/gaming240 or see us in the back of the room for more info.
Yeah, that's right. For any of you in the audience, it's there. You can go there for it.
Right there?
It's 4K. Not 4K.
I'm going now.
Not for that price point.
Well, I want to let you know that we have all sorts of great presentations and games coming up. Let's look at what's coming up in the PC Gaming Show.
What did the guy in the crowd say?
Stay
probably like $3.99?
Hell yeah. Trailers that never before seen footage, including Gearbox answers burning questions about Borderlands 3. The next game from Clay Entertainment. Get ready to rip the galaxy a new wormhole in Valfaris.
You see everybody and stand more. And leave this show. Right there? Okay.
And now the PC Gaming Show presents What's Next from Funcom.
Oh shit. Walk that runway. Damn.
Hello everyone. Thanks
this is the one
applause.
I'm gonna gush on.
It's very exciting for all of us at Funcom to be here at the PC Gaming Show for the very first time ever. And naturally
maybe
we would
not.
Like to
I'll take that back
show some of the cool stuff that we've been working on. So without further ado, here are some of the games coming for 2019.
Something strange is going on all across the
zone. Zero, Gear Zero.
I don't fear
Seed of Evil.
Until now.
Is this like a second game for it? Because I think the first one came out already, I believe. Just like, Nah, that's all you, man.
A lot's happened since you've been traveling, Khan. You could use your skills.
No, I'll take it back. Hey, take it back. Backs, right? What happens to you? Hey, welcome, Pei. Welcome to the show, man. It's good to see you here. There's like about a 10, 15 second delay, so if I don't respond quick enough, that's the reason why. Yo, this Conan Unconquered game, Jay, if you're down on RTS games, we gotta play this game. This is cool as fuck. Check out gameplay on that. It's like a survival mode kind of RTS game. Moons of Madness, Halloween 2019. I think Gutsy should be home in the next 2 hours or so. That's usually when he gets home, Wakabe, so if he gets home early from work, he may join us for, I think, Ubisoft just next.
Off to fly among the stars.
Fun call.
Please welcome to the stage, founder and director of Mighty Kingdom, Philip Mays.
So yeah, at Funcom we've been doing our own games for over 26 years now. But recently we had the great pleasure to be working with some other very talented developers and help them publish their games. And on that note, I'd like to introduce Phil Mays. He is founder of Mighty Kingdom, a studio out of Australia, who has been working with us on something a little different.
Thank you, Natasha. So on April 1st this year, we put out a little trailer for something called Conan Chop Chop.
So down for
and,
Ubisoft.
Considering the date, I think they start at 4, so people decided that that was
we're
April
probably
going to
have a little bit of a break in between.
Yeah, we have a little surprise for you.
Now, the PC gaming show usually runs pretty long, so I expect them to run maybe 2 hours. We're about 30 minutes in right now, so maybe another hour and a half. If it's shorter than that, we'll probably take a break. Everybody can go eat, have a break, and then we'll come back for the Ubisoft show. Bro, that animation. Bro, it reminds me of those old ass Flash games. Conan Chop Chop, all right. Cartooning Conan. Gotta use that license up.
So there you have it, Conan Chop Chop. It's a roguelike action-adventure game. It's very real, and it's coming to PC, Xbox One, PlayStation 4, and Nintendo Switch on September the 3rd this year. It's 2019.
The Switch.
We also have a playable version here at E3 at our demo room, so if you want to give stick figure Conan a try, then please don't hesitate to drop by. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I'm surprised they could even announce anything for like the Switch or other platforms on the PC gaming show.
Last Oasis is a nomadic survival game set in a post-apocalyptic future where the Earth has stopped rotating. The last humans need to outrun the blazing sun in massive open-world environments.
Girl, Jay. She does have nice eyes.
But cheer up, sunshine. This is one of the most original-looking multiplayers we've seen, with interesting ideas underneath. A player-driven economy, and some truly incredible death machines. Coming to early access on Steam on July 15th, let's take a trip to the last oasis.
Jay's like, she's got my dimples. She's cute.
We must move forward or die beneath the sun.
Oh, is this like Mad Max? show. What is this? Some Mad Max pirate game? Look at that shit go, man. Yo. They've boarded the ship. Oh, and then there's a flying one. Nice. Or just a bigger one. Last Oasis. Baby girl. Age of Wonders. Age of Wonders is back. I've never played an Ace of Wonders game, though.
Age of Wonders Planetfall, a 4X strategy game, and joining me on the stage to talk about it is the game director, Leonard Sass, and principal gameplay developer, Tom Bird. Welcome, guys.
Hi.
Good to be here.
This really is going to be
Leonard,
a long show.
Just give us the
They're
gist
getting everybody
of what
on
Age
stage.
Of Wonders Planetfall is all about.
Sure. Age of Wonders is a turn-based strategy game where you play as one of the survivors of a shattered galactic empire. At the start of the game, you choose or create your own faction.
Yeah.
They include the Vanguard Expeditionary Forces, who are in cryosleep when everything went to hell. There's scavenging cyborgs, or the Amazon bioengineers who ride dinosaurs into battle.
Yeah. You know, I want to ask, because there's a pretty broad range of 4X strategy games, to give a sense of what the gameplay is, I just want to start from the beginning of a game. What happens when you first land on the planet?
Well, each race has their own spaceship. The spaceship comes down onto the planet. The planet is where the entire game takes place. Mm-hmm. And that spaceship will then transform into your capital colony, where your entire empire begins, your sort of attempt to take over the world. Around you, you've got a number of sectors, and each of these sectors has a little story. Well, not most of them. So maybe you'll find a genetics lab, which is still full of horrible mutant creatures, an entertainment complex overrun by horrible robot monsters, a temple with holes in the sky and horrible demons who come and get you.
And I did see in the trailer dinosaurs with lasers, correct?
Dinosaurs with lasers.
Perfect.
Well, cats with lasers. No, sorry. No cats with lasers.
I'm so sorry to disappoint all of you. No cats with lasers. You have to settle with dinosaurs. You know, I saw the expansive tech tree show up in the game briefly, and I know that growing resources and tech is a huge part of strategy games. How does that function?
Right, so part of these tech trees come from your origin race. They sort of represent the past of where you came from. They include new units, new modules for your units, like jetpacks for your troopers, orbital laser cannons you can launch from space, social doctrines, it's not all about war. And then the second part of your tech tree comes from your secret technology.
Just not
that's
interested
all about the
in
future
this game
of
at
faction.
All.
So you can create like a combination between man and machine or man and computers.
Yeah.
Others include doomsday technologies that allows you to infect the entire population with alien brain-eating parasites or win the game by splitting space-time.
I love how many details you're giving me of the horrors that await on the planet.
The future is not a pretty place.
Well, I want to ask about some of the combat that we saw, because in a lot of strategy games, the combat can be very brief. It just, you know, shows two armies pinging off each other. But I understand that the tactical layer is quite rich.
Right, so when combat starts, you'll see, like on the world map, maybe like a little sort of space lab or something like that. When you go into combat, you will zoom all the way in and you will be inside the lab. You'll see all the pipes and all of the goops flowing around. All of your units, which you've been putting together and built, are now deployed. In turn-based combat, you can move them into cover, use their abilities, shoot laser cannons. Maybe you've chosen the Dvar, so you've got like a bunch of space dwarves in little metal suits. They'll dig holes in the ground, like shoot from the holes. Maybe you've chosen the Kirko, sort of horrible alien bug monsters. They run forwards and slash people and puke acid on them, that kind of thing.
I mean, how long do some of these battles wind up lasting?
It depends. A short battle can be maybe 2 or 3 minutes, but at the end of the game, you know, you've got a massive siege with like 20 units on your side, 20 units on their side. You've got orbital cannons blasting holes in the world. And that can maybe take 30 minutes.
Well, talk to us about when we can play the game.
Okay. The game is due this August 6th. It's going to be available on PC, multiple platforms, consoles, and it's available
for pre-order now. I just feel like if you don't already know what Age of Wonders
what's
is.
What's that URL?
It's AOW-planetfall.com.
You're probably not going to be joining.
Well, I'm looking forward to it. It's less than 2 months away. Gentlemen, thanks so much for joining.
They've had a long franchise already, so.
Bye-bye, guys.
Everybody who's hyped about Age of Wonders is already in. You don't really need to be up there and talk about it that long.
What year is it?
Why, the year is 1946, Sean, my dear boy. Europe lies in ruins, torn apart by the satanic
Plan Z. She got a thicker accent there, Jay. You like that?
Into hell, but little
what if she talked to you like
the nightmare
that,
nightmare is far from over. Ak-Chung, this is the world-exclusive reveal of the next shooter from the makers of Sniper Elite 4.
That was heavy, man. That was heavy.
Rated M for mature.
Get up. They're coming for you. That gun's not enough. Get up. I got back up. Hurry up and get up. Let's go. Holy shit, zombies with flamethrowers. What? Nice. Coming for you too, man. Oh, you got that tripwire. Give you an extra 2 seconds.
Hey, over here! Roger that.
Just die.
Come on, let's go.
Oh, you got the flamethrower now. Hells yeah. I like how none of them are on fire from the flamethrower. You didn't do a very good job. Alright, you got one, two, time to go, boy! Kind of like Left 4 Daddy. Is that fucking Hitler? Zombie Army Dead War 4.
Later on the PC gaming show.
Never played any of the other ones.
A love letter to classic JRPGs. What's next for Warframe? A surreal noir adventure set before, during, and after the Big Bang. Baldur's Gate 3 and more.
Yeah, I'm looking for Baldur's Gate.
ravaged the Earth. An unending assault without reason. We are victims to a hatred.
They just tear through that gate like nothing? Yeah, man.
This evil will consume our world.
They like the tickle of the electricity, man. Beyond.
Unless you rise to meet it. A trial by fury and blood.
Man, I hate this Wi-Fi. Sorry, man. I don't know if it's my connection or not, but...
Prepare yourselves. They
hopefully not.
Here.
I got the video playing on another page here. I haven't seen too much issue on my side, so... Yo, look at this crazy-ass monster, though. Remnant from the Ashes. Oh, from Perfect World? Heh. Unexpected.
Joining me on the stage to talk about Remnant from the Ashes and that trailer, we got the chance to see so much new gameplay footage and new environments. Let's welcome the CEO of Gunfire Games, David Adams. So David, I want to ask right away, for those who are unfamiliar with Remnant from the Ashes, what kind of game is it?
So Remnant's a co-op action shooter set on an apocalyptic Earth and across a bunch of cool fantasy worlds.
Co-op action shooter.
And I mean, in that trailer,
shooter.
We got the chance to see a huge variety of different environments.
We're going in on that.
All these different places. Who's the
player? That crazy-headed guy.
So as a player, you're on sort of a Odyssey-like quest to save the world, and we really wanted to have a bunch of different cool locales that you go to just to experience a bunch of different stuff. And you start on Earth, but it rapidly changes very quickly as you get into the game.
And one thing that we've talked about before is that replayability is a huge focus of the game, that you could play through it 10 times and still be seeing new bosses, new monsters, new locations. How exactly does that work?
Yeah, I think one of the coolest features of the game is the dynamic generation system. So we generate the maps, the enemies, the quests, NPCs, bosses, everything.
You've built those all by hand, right?
Yeah, it's all hand scripted, but the system takes all the pieces and stitches it together. So you might play the game and come into work and say, hey, I talked to a giant tree and fought a dragon boss, and I'd be like, I met a guy in a helicopter, an old guy in a helicopter, and killed a tree ant. And we'd have completely different experiences and, playing the same game.
And you just have to keep going through and eventually explore what all the possibilities are.
Yeah, you can play the game over and over again to see the stuff. You can jump into your friend's world to experience the content in their world, and that's a big part of the game, just jumping in and seeing what
that's
you get.
Interesting.
Well, I want to ask about loot, which is, I understand, a big part of the game. How does it function alongside this ever-shifting gameplay experience?
Yeah, the loot in the game is all legendary items, and it's tied into the dynamic generation. So if you
fight
a boss,
this is your
or
type
meet
of
NPC
game,
or
Jay?
Get a cool unique side quest, it generally coincides with a cool unique item. It might be a boss weapon or a magical item or armor. So if you play the game and you get all completely
You gotta give up Destiny for this.
And in the trailer, I also saw that there were three people walking through these. And you mentioned the co-op experience. How does co-op function in the world?
So the game is full co-op from beginning to end. You can jump in at any point. And the game's definitely slower paced, more difficult. I mean, you will die a lot in this game. So
awesome.
There's a huge advantage to bring your friends to come in there and help you take down bosses or fight off different events or just generally progress through the world.
Yeah, well, I mean, as a big fan of Bloodborne and Dark Souls, I'm really looking forward to Remnant from the Ashes. What's the release date, and where can people go for more information?
So Remnant's coming out August 20th on PC and
pretty soon,
Xbox,
man.
And PS4. And if you pre-order the game now, you can actually get in early and start playing the game August 16th.
Well, awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, David Adams from Gunfire Games. Thanks so much for talking to us about Remnant. And as we mentioned earlier, keep those questions coming. I will be asking on stage the creative director of Borderlands 3, everything you want to know. Doesn't matter what platform you're on, just use hashtag PCGamingShow. And until that time, let's talk about our next title. This one was announced 2 years ago at the PC Gaming Show here. It's a game from Clay Entertainment called Griftlands. It's changed quite a bit in the last 2 years. It's now a deck-building roguelike where you don't just fight, but you also negotiate your way through a broken-down sci-fi world. It's going to be available on the Epic Game Store in one short month on July 11th in alpha. Let's take a look at some of the footage of what you'll be playing.
Are you
Deck card deck games are not my my thing.
Is the latest game from the makers of the brilliant Planet Coaster. Please welcome Piers Jackson and Lisa Borans from Frontier Development.
Gonna get Planet Zoo.
Now, Piers, what kind of zoo are we gonna be running here?
So Planet Zoo is a new management sim game from us. It involves you building and looking after a modern zoo, and you get to look after the most
not a Jurassic Park, but a modern zoo.
Each of our animals are unique. They have their own needs, their own desires, and their own behaviors. They interact with each other and react with the world you build around them. And today, for the very first time, we're really excited to show everyone here a gameplay video and to announce our launch date.
Oh, fantastic. Let's buy the world's largest family pass and take a look inside.
It'd be really cool if they could somehow put Planet Zoo and Planet Coaster together. To be able to like make a giant park that has both in it. Kinda like bush gardens. Yo, this is jolly as hell though. Ooh. You know, pick up poo all day. Oh, that's awesome. Yeah, man, this is my thing. Simba.
Lisa, I love some of the animal shenanigans here. I mean, hippos pooing,
yeah.
Adorable baby elements, it's absolutely brilliant. I can't wait to play it. But before we saw the trailer, Piers mentioned this is a modern zoo, but what exactly does that mean?
So nowadays when you go to the zoo, you're not just going to see all the lovely, pretty animals. You go there, you want to be, you know, learning about conservation, you want to learn about the research that they're doing, you want to be educated. And these are all things that you're going to be able to do in Planet Zoo. And these ideas of the modern zoo is really what we take to heart, and we're going to be promoting, you know, the health and the welfare of your animals as the most important thing to do.
And Piers, when can we see more gameplay, and when are we going to be able to get our hands on it ourselves?
So we're obviously demoing the game all this week at E3, but most people aren't going to be able to see that. So we've recorded our presentation. Lisa's done a fantastic voiceover for it, and we'll be releasing that onto Frontier's YouTube channel. That goes live this Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific time.
Well, fantastic. I cannot wait to watch. Thank you so much for joining us, Piers and Lisa, everyone.
Cheers.
Next up, we have a very special guest all the way from Japan.
Please welcome to the stage gaming industry legend and Shenmue creator, Yu Suzuki.
Oh, Shenmue.
That
is Shenmue coming
right
to that PC?
Ladies and gentlemen, joining me on the stage is a legend of Japanese game development. It's Mr. Yu Suzuki.
Yo, I know people hype for
Hello,
this.
Hello, everyone.
In addition to being the brains behind the following games, Hang On, Space Harrier, Outrun, Afterburner, Virtual Racing, and Virtual Fighter, Yusan also created the Shenmue series, and he's here to talk about Shenmue 3 right now. Take it away, Yusan.
Tell us more.
この場に立てて光栄です。I am so honored to be here standing on the stage today. それと20年支えてくれたあのファンの皆さん、ありがとう。
I just want to say thank you to the, all the fans supporting me for the long 20 years. Thank you very much.
The wait. The wait is nearly over.
That's right. Let's take a world-exclusive look at Shenmue 3.
Didn't they say it would be coming out next year, though? Like, early next year?
Honestly, I don't think your kung fu is strong
enough.
Oh,
they got that English voiceover.
Grandmaster, I...
Okay.
A long time ago, martial arts were bad, but humans are interesting creatures. They practiced in secret, away from prying eyes, and became stronger. One even practiced atop this very boat. Nam Tren survived the ban and was passed on in this way.
Oof.
What did you say to me? Stop it. They threaten and extort money from shop owners, get drunk by noon, and cause trouble. Everyone in town is afraid of them. They are heartless.
Hey,
wait right there!
Oh, snap. Okay. Save the girl.
This is him! The Japanese guy who got in our way!
You've got some guts to barge in here on your own.
I know so many people have been waiting for Shenmue 3. I would like to once again thank you so much. Thank you, Yusan, for joining us today.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Where I know friends who are going to be
now
replaying
our next
that
title
trailer
is near
up and
dear
down
to my
so many times
heart.
Tonight.
It's based upon a game I grew up playing called Heroes of Might and Magic 2. Let's take a look at an upcoming collaboration between Coffee Stain Studios and Lava Potion.
This is pretty jolly.
It's near and it's far, in human and the
land. Oh, he's singing.
Beasts of the land, it flows through the forest, it breathes the sand.
Lightning and thunder in crackling waste, a land torn asunder by night and by day. The Empress eternal with death and decay. To march upon cities with frost and with rain. They gather on the wheelers and build mighty walls. Resisting, revolting, their harvest will fall. So
wheel is an RTS game or?
Command and draw out their essence you hold in your hand. Unleashed on them all.
Some kind of adventure game.
Will raise every bill to take back what was ours.
Oh shit, wizards here. Song Sung Conquest, classic adventure strategy. So maybe like a turn-based tactics
game? The name of the game is Songs of Conquest, and here to join me in talking about it is the lead designer from Lava Potion, Carl Toftfeld. Hey,
yeah.
Carl.
Hi, hey, thanks.
I mean, let's just start off, for anyone who maybe hasn't played the Heroes of Might and Magic series, what is Song of Conquest all about?
It's all about, you kind of start out with in the town that you just saw in the end of
right.
the trailer. And from there, you recruit your wielders, is what we call our commanders. And you recruit an army, and then you kind of send off your wielders on an adventure. And they go exploring the world, they pick up resources to flag mines, and with those resources, you upgrade your town so you can get more stuff, and that's kind of what you do. Adventure and strategy combined.
Yeah, and, you know, I know that part of the core loop is, obviously, get the resources to build up the township, but for what reason? Armies, man. Talk to me about those juicy battles.
Yeah, so the battle, just like the whole game, is turn-based.
True that.
So you go into combat, you bring all your troops in, and you start by deploying them, and then all the troops have different stats, like offense and defense and health
and so on.
And they go in initiative order, and then you slug it out, and it's a bit like chess, but instead of like pawns and bishops, you have like horned wands and face spirits.
Great, and griffins and so on.
Yeah, and all those things.
And well, you know, as someone who just loves the Heroes of Might and Magic series, I know that you have translated a lot of the gameplay elements into Songs of Conquest, but what are some of the modern elements that you're bringing in?
Well, there's a lot of it, but I mean, one of them is our magic system. We call it the essence. So basically, in the Songs of Conquest universe, everything has
those giant ass shoes on the map.
So your troops, they have an essence. And to do magic, you need to bring the troops with the right essence with your wielder's skills.
Oh, I see.
So if you want to like make your troops go faster, you need to bring a troop that has that essence, like cavalry.
And maybe to ask a basic question, what if my opponent kills that cavalry?
Then you can't do the magic. So.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah, so if you're fighting someone, you kind of have to like weigh the pros and cons of what to kill off. Like, do you want to destroy their magic or their powerful troops?
Where can people go to get more information? And as always, when's it coming out?
In late 2020.
Oh, it's quite a ways off.
It's quite a ways off, but you can go to songsofconquest.com and sign up for alpha.
Yeah, it's a long
way. And then you can play earlier.
Well,
next gen will be here by then.
Really looking forward to playing it, Carl. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
Now, our next title is an update to a popular co-op game. Let's see what's in store for Vermintide 2.
Hey, Vermintide. Hells yeah. I need to pick up the new one. I hear the story's like getting crazy, though, on the second one. For those of you who don't know, this is like a Left 4 Dead Warhammer game. But with like pretty good story to it. Oh, so you're playing the enemies. Oh. Okay. I thought
you
this was going to be
the
a DLC
of the new PvP mode coming to Vermintide 2, which turns
That's
the Warhammer
cool.
Fantasy cooperative game into something even more brutally competitive. It looks deliciously vile, and surely dismembering Skaven is so much more satisfying when you know you're going ham on a fellow player, making him or her cry little baby rat tears behind their computer screen. You can sign up now for the Vermintide 2 versus beta at vermintide2.com/version.
Jay, don't clip that.
In Per Aspera, you're an artificial consciousness orbiting Mars, whose ultimate purpose is to terraform the planet, starting from a single drone in your landing site and turning the planet into a flourishing second home for humanity. Courtesy of developer Talon Industries and publisher Raw Fury, here's a first ever look at Per Aspera.
As we all know, reaching the Red Planet was not humanity's greatest achievement. Transferring the complexity of the human mind to machines was. So they can succeed where we fail. So they can build us a home on that distant, dusty rock. Today, Amy reaches Mars and begins their mission. Amy.
That's where you've been. You reached
Are you with
Mars.
Us?
Of course, I'm with you, Houston.
Oh, damn, we're gonna terraform Mars and stuff. Cool.
In the Assassin's Creed universe, our next guest sent players back in time to rewrite history. But for his debut project with indie studio Panache Digital Games, he's going to take us back 10 million years to where humanity began. Here to tell us all about Ancestors is creative director and co-founder Patrice Desilet. Welcome, Patrice.
Thank you for having me. I'm really happy to be here. I've been waiting 10 years.
Yes.
To come back on a big stage at E3 showing off a game.
Well, it's fantastic.
He does look familiar to me.
I just want to ask, what inspired you to tell the story of Human Evolution?
He looks familiar.
Well, when I started Panache, I needed a game, an open world game in which you can do a lot of things. You need a character in a 3D environment at first. And I said, oh, I'm the historical guy. I'm the historical dude. So I need an historical period.
Let's go back at the very beginning.
It'll be easier
to
do.
One of the guys who worked on Assassin's Creed.
Because I won't have to build a city. I won't have to build technology.
And he's doing this like ancestor game. Okay.
Because we built Africa 10 million years ago. And that's not easy to build.
It doesn't sound easy. I mean, how have you turned those themes into gameplay?
Well, you play our last common ancestor. Right, of all the big apes, and then you have to explore your environment, and eventually you expand your territory, you expand your clan, because you're not playing that one badass character. You play a group of badass character. And eventually you evolve into different species, up until Lucy the Australopithecus, roughly 2 million years ago.
I imagine our ancestors had a lot more issues to deal with than we do today. There's going to be a lot more dangers in this world, so tell me a bit more about those.
Well, it's all about from a prey to a predator. Basically, at the beginning of the game, everybody's there to kill you and devour you. And basically, at the end, it's pretty much you. You're the predator, and everybody's afraid of you. And that's the idea of Ancestors.
It looks better than the last time they showed it.
So, Patrice, ultimately, what is the key to evolving your clan successfully?
Curiosity. You need to explore. Because, you know, I made a game about characters and you needed to follow the story I wrote for you. This time, you're basically writing the story. Right? There's no story per se inside. It's not about going and see mission givers. It's not about looking at the mini-maps and the little dots. It's about you, Homo sapiens. Can you survive like our ancestors did? And that's the question I'm asking the players. It'll be for you to answer that question August 27th.
Well, I was going to
on PC first.
I was going to ask you when we can see it, and you answered my question first. Thank you so much,
I'm getting
Patrice.
Good at this.
As Patrice says, Ancestors will be released August 27th, and you can learn more at ancestorsgame.com.
Thank you.
You said it too. Oh my God. Here's that epic storm montage. Who says you can't do what you wanna do? When you let it go, there ain't no stopping you. It's do or don't, there ain't no try. So do your thing and drop the mic. Here we go. I don't believe my eyes. Oh, those games. I remember seeing that game on the PlayStation last year. Oh, the Goose Game! Untitled Goose Game! I want to play this game. What the golf? Definitely looks Korean to me. Is this that Dota chess game auto chess. Okay, I mean, it's the same idea.
Please welcome to the stage, Loring Lee, founder and CEO of Dragon Nest.
Indeed, auto chess has turned out to be a sensation with hundreds of thousands, millions of players getting a taste of it. And here to talk about its coming to PC is Loring Lee. Take it away, Loring.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. I'm Loring Lee.
Hi, Loring Lee.
Hello. Hello. Yeah. I'm the CEO and founder of Dragon's Game. Dragon's Game is a game developer and publisher, comes from China. I'm so happy to be here today on this stage to introduce our game, Auto Chess, to all of you. This is really an exciting moment for us. As the trailer says, this is a real engaging game of Auto Chess. Dragon's Game now is working with the creator of Auto Chess, Jodo Studio. We are working together to bring Auto Chess to our world, both on PC and mobile, so that everyone from anywhere with any device can enjoy the same fun of Auto Chess. Now we are building the PC version by using the gaming engine of Unreal Engine 4. As everyone knows, Unreal Engine is one of the best gaming engines of the world. With the help of Epic Games and by the power of Unreal, I believe we can finish our job quickly and efficiently. And today,
they give this guy way too many long lines.
The PC version of Auto Chess will be coming to the Epic Games Store. I look forward. I look forward to all of you playing Auto Chess on PC later this year. Okay, thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Loring Lee.
Yeah, cool.
Thank you, Loring Lee.
Thanks so much for sharing the news with us.
You're back.
Once again, Auto Chess, if you have not played it, you must check it out. It is so fun. Our next title with Frankie up above, I understand, is an inspired indie game.
We'll find out, Sean, because one of the things we love about PC gaming is the way that game creators from all over the world can draw inspiration from one another's work. Chris Tales is a great example of that, a gorgeous indie love letter to classic JRPGs developed by a team in Colombia. Chris Tales' spin on the genre brings a unique perspective that lets you see the past, present,
Colombia?
And future
like my Colombia?
At the same
Where
time.
I'm from?
So you'll see the future change based on your decisions in real time. Here's the world-exclusive reveal of Chris Tales.
If you saw what was, what is, and what would be. If you knew how it ends.
Yo, are my people making a JRPG?
Could you make the hard decisions? And would you be strong enough to fight?
Yo, this is stylish. I like this. This is kind of like Child of Light with another different animation style.
If you learn from the past, and act in the present, you can rewrite the future.
Dude. All right. Oh, play the demo now. Sweet.
In PC gaming, it's not the size of your weapon. It's how you use it. And I'm holding one of the, well, quite frankly, it's a bit average, isn't it? It's just your average, you know, Glock, really. No, it's one of the ridiculous alien weapons from our next game, Valfaris, a brutal, heavy metal-infused 2G action platformer inspired by true old-school classics like Contra and Turrican. Assuming the role of fearless warrior Therium, players must blast and slash their way through the doomed citadel of Valfaris, overcoming its deadly environments and enemies before challenging the arcane.
Where the hell is the trigger on that gun?
Get ready to rip the galaxy a new wormhole. From publisher Big Sugar, this is Valfaris.
Too much. But I'm down for a Contra-esque game. Look at that shit. Fucking metal as fuck. I'm in on this.
Just incredible action in the Valforest trailer. I'm very excited for our next guest. In case you have not been in downtown LA, E3 is covered with Borderlands 3 art. It's amazing, it's beautiful. And joining me is the amazing and beautiful Paul Sage, creative director of Borderlands 3.
Beautiful's a new one, thanks.
Yeah, there you go, Paul. Welcome. I mean, there's been so much hype around Borderlands 3. What's the stuff you're really excited to be sharing this year at E3?
Oh man, so you know, we've talked about our Vault Hunters. Well, this time we get to talk about Moe's, and she is our Gunner Vault Hunter, so yeah. She has a big mech, so it's one of the things. All about loot, we're talking about, you know, the different loots, such as shields, grenades, those yeah. things, going to different planets, so a lot of stuff to talk about.
Well, I mean, I want to start right off with Moe's. Tell us everything you can about her.
Okay, yes, I'll tell you everything I can. So Moe's, again, like I said, she's a mech pilot. She has this big mech, it's called Iron Bear. She gets into Iron Bear.
Yeah.
You know, we have multiple action
nice
skills,
name.
Which means that she can equip either a minigun or a railgun or a flamethrower. You know, if you want to barbecue your enemy, something like that.
Oh,
so,
nice.
You
know, match.
Yeah, Moe's is a terrifically fun character for us right now.
Now, we've been excited to be collating a whole bunch of community questions. We're gonna break them into two categories. First, there's a whole bunch of repeat questions that I wanna make sure we get to right now. One of the big categories is about loot, because you've mentioned having a billion guns earlier, but what can you tell us about some of the other gear, the other progression systems
right
in the game?
Yeah, so let's talk about grenades, like one of my favorite things that we don't get to talk about a lot. So in the past, we've had grenades that they've had yeah. like one thing, they can bounce, they can stick to different things, you know?
Yeah.
This time we're combining like all of those things. So for instance, the other day I was playing and I threw a grenade and that grenade had a bounce, it would stick, an explosion would come out, and the grenade would fire guns as it was going through, right? So we have like a ton of different grenades that are in there.
Uh-oh. Shield's got a hiccup.
Shield where if you duck,
there
that shield
go.
Will extend out in front of you, you know, so
oh,
just tons of different things that we have, you know, with our characters. Class mods are unique, and that they give you skills this time as
I
well.
I think this is on their end, guys, so if you see
I
any
also
hiccups,
remember earlier you mentioned about
stay
artifacts.
Tuned.
What are those?
So artifacts are, you know, we've kind of concentrated on like, hey, does the game feel fluid? Can I, you know, slide into things? Can I jump? Can I mantle?
Right, right.
Right. So when we were playing with that, we slid into a barrel, right? And the barrel exploded and we're like, well, that's kind of fun.
Yeah.
So why don't we do something like that? So our artifacts actually add certain things to movement. So
why do things always
factor,
break
you can
during
slide
a
in every time you slide, there's an explosion.
Like
we have
demo
something we call
showing. It's always during Borderlands, things break.
Second category of questions unrelated to loot. Category of questions unrelated
to loot.
I feel like
people are hacking.
There's going to be a single player
during
campaign.
During every, like,
what's going to be happening after the campaign?
Showing.
What are some of the beyond the single player, maybe end game content that you can talk
they
about?
I really hate
all right,
end game
content.
Picture.
Okay, well, it's E3, so I'll give a little bit. So we have this thing what we call the Guardian system. So for those people who played Borderlands before, you might remember Badass Ranks. Badass Ranks. You can get, you know, it's basically kind of an infinite progression system that added to your stats.
Yeah.
We doubled down on that. We have what we call Guardian Rank. And Guardian Rank not only has that infinite progression, but it has skills and different skins that you can open up as you go through. And the cool thing about that is, like, every character that you play on that
is
account,
there a dog
gets the
and
benefits
can I
of Guardian
pet it?
Oh, interesting. All right, great last question. Category we're going to go through, and then we're going to hit some rapid-fire questions. How do the boss fights in Borderlands 3 compare to Borderlands 1 and 2? I know those were big aspects. How do you build upon that?
Right, so I think of a boss fight, you know, like I'm an old school Nintendo fan, right? So I love huge boss fights that have like three phases and stuff like that. So now those people, you know, smart people in the audience know that we've talked about going to vaults instead of vault, right? And so there are like huge boss encounters there that are just, you know, multi-phase boss encounters. We have like a lot of different mini bosses throughout the game. So a lot of different boss encounters throughout the game.
Well, now I want to ask some really quick questions that should be yes or no, very brief. First from Castoray, how will you be handling multiplayer?
Multiplayer, we will basically be allowing anybody to jump in at any time, so.
Awesome, from MHL Animations, can I pet the gun? Great question.
I'm not here to judge what you do with your gun, so you know, you that's a personal question.
All right, great. Sam Wiseman asks, is Maya's new companion a siren?
People are asking the right questions. That's what I will say about that.
Oh, you tease.
Sorry.
All right, from Ironic Sanguine says, is Tiny Tina going to be seen fighting alongside the Vault Hunters?
Yes.
Yeah, nice. Tiny Tina.
All right, I'm just going to blast through a couple more as fast as I possibly can. Right. What's the level cap at launch?
50.
Will we get to see Flack?
Yes.
Will we see golden keys and or shift codes for Borderlands 3?
Absolutely.
Will there be duels?
Yes.
Other kinds of PvP?
Yes and no.
And also maybe.
And
perfect.
Maybe, yeah.
And will you be able to transfer weapons between your characters?
And also maybe.
Absolutely,
not.
Right from the start.
Perfect. Oh. And when is the damn game coming out?
Friday the 13th, 2019, September 13th.
Perfect. Borderlands.com for more information. Thanks so much for joining me on stage.
Sean, thank you.
And once again, if you have not seen all the setups in downtown for Borderlands 3, they're beautiful. Our next game, we're going to be revisiting a guest that we saw earlier in the show. He's upstairs with Frankie. What you got for us?
A shark.
Oh, hi, we're live. Sorry. Hello, I was just, I was actually testing out my outfit for this weekend. I don't know, what do you think, John?
I think you look really sharp, as always.
Very sharp. Well, thank you so much. John Gibson, president of Tripwire, thank you for joining us again on the show.
Yeah, very
excited
to be here.
Very busy man, yes.
Yes.
Now, last year, we revealed Maneater to the world, and can you remind anyone who missed it?
Oh, that shark game.
Absolutely. Maneater is an open world action RPG, or shark PG as we call it. You start as a small baby shark pup, and you have to survive in this harsh world and try to eat your way to the top
like
of the ecosystem.
Yeah, like the Jaws type
kind of game. The three words that we think sum the game up the best are eat, explore, and evolve. And we also have someone we'd like you to meet.
Well, let's meet him then. Let's take a look at the new trailer.
Baby shark, do-do-do-do-do-do, baby shark, do-do-do-do-do-do. Is it gonna be Keanu Reeves? Is Keanu Reeves in this fucking thing too? Can I be a hammerhead shark?
Any closer with that camera, we two gonna toss him.
This is a cool game. I think I might enjoy this one.
John, who was that appallingly dressed fisherman in the trailer? Because quite frankly, not even I would eat him.
That was Scaly Pete. And Scaly Pete's the villain in this tale. Pete is a best fisherman in the Gulf, the best shark fisherman, or he'll tell you he's the best shark fisherman.
To respect the shark.
He disfigures a baby shark at the beginning of the game.
That's
he does some
awesome.
Really nasty things. So
I wish I had that
nice
in my
guy.
Fucking stream.
And now the story of Maneater is told through the lens of a reality show called Shark Hunters versus Maneaters. And it follows Pete and
they
the player
put left shark
on its adventures. And it's a really it's a very exciting way to tell a story.
And based on that trailer, to be honest, John, it looks like your main goal of the shark is to just bite everything.
Yeah, there is an awful lot of man eating going on in this game. That is the
so
name of the
weird
game.
To see
and
the shark.
But we'd like to think of the game as a shark-tastic fun action game. It's
yeah,
like
look
GTA
at this.
If you were a shark.
This looks like
but
fun.
If there is more to the game than just eating, so we spent a lot of time moving through the water, breaching out, and adding abilities to go up on the beach for an afternoon snack.
I love it.
There's a lot of exciting things that you can do in the game.
And you mentioned before it's a shark PG. How does that progression system work?
So there's three facets to the Shark PG elements of the game. There's growth, there's life phases, and there's evolutions. So growth comes about through eating things, nutrients, people, whatever you can find. And that's kind of like your XP in the game. That allows you to level up, your shark will grow a little bit, you'll get more powerful. And then at key phases, that we call life phases, you'll make a big jump. So let's say
it's
you're
like playing
Eco
the Dolphin,
shark,
but as a shark.
You're about to become an adult. You take a big leap in size, a big leap in power and capability. And then as you reach these life phases, you unlock evolutions that can be applied to parts of the shark's body. For example, you could get metallic teeth that allow you to shred boats, or a powerful tail that allows you to jump to incredible heights, or you could get mutated lungs that allow you to spend a little more time on the beach getting those afternoon snacks.
Just really quickly, John, everyone's wanting to know this question. When's it coming out?
Oh, so we're really hard hammerheading away at this game and trying to make it the most awesome shark RPG ever.
I see what he did there.
We're not ready to announce a date, but we're pretty certain you're going to see it before the next PC Gaming Show.
Well, I hope we do, John. Otherwise, I'm going to have to start biting people. In fact, I'm quite hungry at the moment, so I think actually I'm going to find an audience member because you guys look tasty. So I'll see you in a bit. I'm just going to have a snack. Thank you, John.
Go take it in the crowd. You're going to bite people. Moderate seat, kind of cheapish, plasticky wheels, meh.
You know, one of the absolute best parts about being sponsored by iWin for the PC Gaming Show is that I get to sit for this next segment and talk to you about Terraria is one of the best-selling PC games of all time, selling almost 30 million copies. And part of the reason why it's maintained such popularity is the fact that the developers Relogic continue to add content, going from 250 items at release to now over 4,000. Let's take a look at their penultimate expansion coming up, Terraria Journey's End.
All right, Terraria's back. I've never played Terraria. Oh, you can play like mini golf. Nope. Well, that froze. I don't think that was supposed to do that.
The next title that we're going to be looking at is a game that is the spiritual successor to Her Story. It's called Telling Lies by Annapurna Interactive, and joining me to talk about it is game director Sam Barlow and actor-producer Logan Marshall Green. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Nice to be here.
Yeah.
My main man.
Now, if you haven't played Her Story, you totally should. It's fantastic. I want to note, it is a game where you watch live interactive video in order to uncover what happened with a murder. What is it that's going on in Telling Lies? What's the premise?
So, like Her Story, Telling Lies is a game in which you watch video footage to piece together a story. And this time, we have a woman who has stolen an NSA hard drive, which contains secretly recorded intimate and private conversations between our four characters. Something has gone terribly wrong, and it's up to you to figure out what and why.
Time to take a look at some of the gameplay mechanics and see Telling Lies in action.
Spying, espionage, detective work. Yo, play solitaire.
Once upon a time.
It's late, I gotta get her in the bath.
I don't love you and I don't miss you.
You already know too much.
It's late. I gotta get her in the bath. Love you. Love you.
I've only ever been in love once. It was with a girl I met when I was 18, but I was too young and naive to handle it properly. And I guess I still carry a torch for it, which makes me an incurable romantic or underdeveloped emotionally. I'm a loyal friend.
Mm-hmm. That girl in bed, though.
A man died in my place at work today. We haven't done anything.
Oh, wow, there's a lot of video.
Oh, Sam, I got some questions for you about what we've just seen. Talk to me about the mechanics. I mean, I saw, you know, the subtitles up, highlighting, and it was loading more video footage. What's going on?
So what we do in Telling Lies is we take all of the exploration you would have in a normal video game, so all that walking around in a 3D world, and we apply that directly to the story, to the footage itself. So you're going to be scrubbing around in these clips, paying close attention, and you're going to be picking up on the subtext, listening to names, people, places. And with that information, you're going to use that to find more clips, dig into those, and over time, kind of build up this picture of the story. And it's truly like an open world video game.
Well, I mean, you know, a lot of times with open world video games, they talk about, you know, the square kilometerage or miles in America. what's the sort of scope that we're talking about? Like, how many hours of footage is there?
So we got like over 10 hours of footage here.
Wow,
so it's a story that encompasses like 2 years. What I wanted to do with this one was, like I say, really embrace this idea of it being an open world game. You're free to explore and follow your curiosity. Just lose yourself in this story, all the characters.
It's so this is a meaty-ass game, then, story for there to be
well,
10 hours
Logan,
of footage you have to probably rewatch every once
like
in a while
to
figure it out.
Try to have all the layers in there for each performance, also not knowing when a player is going to be seeing the specific footage you're performing.
Well, it's definitely a non-linear open-world game, but our approach and Sam's approach was not unlike a movie or a TV show, and we had to understand it A to B. And so, for the most part, that's how we shot it. Obviously, when you're shooting a movie or a TV show, and in this case, a game, you're gonna be shooting out of order, but we actually stayed pretty linear in how we approached the story. We went after it like all the other times we're actors. We just went after intention, and what do we want? And we tried to make it as deep. You know, it's got a lot of scope.
Yeah.
But we wanted to make it as deep as possible, and Sam is one of the best movie or TV directors I've worked with, so it was very similar.
This guy.
Nice. Yeah, look at you two. Yeah. Now, of course, I do want to stress to any of you, if you have not played Her Story, it's quick to play through, it's absolutely brilliant. Please check it out in the meantime, but we're, of course, waiting to find out, when can we play Telling Lies?
Very soon, I promise. We'll have a date soon. Right now, you can go to Steam, you can wishlist it on Steam, we all love Steam, and yeah. Very soon. We'll be showing a little bit more during E3, and the game will be out, very soon.
Fantastic.
Desperate to get it out there.
Yeah.
And people to play it.
As soon as humanly possible.
Yeah.
Well, Sam, Logan, thanks so much for joining me on stage. Once again, Telling Lies.
I wonder what they're waiting to
now, up
pull
on the balcony,
for.
Frankie's going to be talking to us about a game that my friends, year after year after year, keep telling me I have to play because of how much they've improved it. Frankie, what's going on with Warframe?
Well, one of my favorite parts of last year's show, aside from being upstaged by a giant duck, was getting a glimpse at the future of Warframe. And here with the latest look at the next expansion to the universe is Space Mum Rebecca Ford. So, chat, behave yourselves, please, because Mother's here. Now, Rebecca, what are we about to see?
We're going to take a look at an amazing trailer that our team has put together. A lot of our players have been waiting a year for a look at what we've been calling Railjack, so it's about time to, you know, see what we've been doing.
Yeah, let's take a look.
Thank you.
My headset's almost dying here. Gotta switch the battery while we're listening to this. Back. Yeah, the show's starting to drag on a little bit.
It must be so exciting to know that the fans are finally seen it, and you're clearly going all in on the epic space combat. So tell me about the new stuff that players are going to be able to experience.
I wasn't shaking before we started talking, and now I am because it's real. Because, you know, Empyrean is what we're calling codename Railjack. It's basically taking the space ninja part of Warframe, sending it back up to space, bringing players that squad gameplay they know, taking the enemies like the Corpus and the Grineer, giving them their own Railjack to, you know, essentially explore the solar system with and take down the bad guys.
And when are fans going to get to see more?
Well, TennoCon is in London, Ontario. It's July 6th, and you can come watch it online on Twitch. We're going to be showing a lot more in our keynote for what Empyrean is going to be.
Well, today I'm getting a feel for the suit, so what's the deal with that sweet-looking Necros Prime? How do I get my Tenno arms into it?
I cannot say that on live television, but, you know, there are ways. But, yeah, you just have to watch, link your Warframe account to your Twitch account. If you watch 30 minutes of our Tenno live show, you can get it, but hopefully you stay for the whole hour, because we got lots to show.
Well, thank you so much, Rebecca, and good luck with TennoCon on July 6th.
Thank you.
Okay, now, we've seen some amazing stuff today.
Just so
nothing
excited.
Quite so gloriously strange is our next game. Developed by Brooklyn-based studio Feral Cat Den, it's an existential bass jazz odyssey set during the Big Bang. Yeah, it's actually blown my mind learning about this one. Buckle up, everyone, because we're about to get bonkers with Genesis Noir.
She's got that charisma. Like noir type games, but what's this? Like a detective game? It's definitely unique. To the swish.
Genesis Noir, just beautiful, stylish art. The next game we're going to take a look at is the twist on the stealth genre. It's called El Hijo, where you play as a six-year-old trying to escape a monastery and find your mother using toys and tricks to avoid monks. Let's take a look at this gorgeous spaghetti western-inspired project from Studio Handy Games.
Spaghetti western. Time to lock up, guys. El Hijo is here. Oh, it really is a stealthy type game. Why is he stealthy around for? What's he trying to uncover? Okay. Yo, this is like straight up Metal Gear.
El Hijo, once again, is the title of the trailer we just saw. For our final guest tonight, please join me in welcoming
final game.
From Larian Studios, CEO Sven
Baldur's
Vinken,
Gate, let's
and
go.
From Dungeons & Dragons at Wizards of the Coast,
probably
the creative director of Dungeons
minutes
& Dragons,
before
Mike Merles,
2 hours.
To talk about Baldur's Gate
and
3.
Another hour for Ubisoft.
Yeah! Now, this was only just recently announced. How did this partnership come about?
Oh, no, limited run.
We went
next.
To see Wizards of the Coast at the end of Divinity Original Sin 1.
Yeah.
That was back in 2014. And I tried to convince them back then that they should give us the Baldur's Gate 3 license. And they said, eh. And so, but we had a long chat about what the vision would be for the game. And then we kept on bumping into each other.
Okay, I
and
need
then,
to start setting up for
in,
limited run.
2016, I get a phone call from Nathan Stewart.
I'm going to be listening to Baldur's Gate, of course.
Head of Dungeons and Dragons. He said, you need to come
excuse
to
me if
right
I'm
away.
On my little laptop
we're gonna
here.
We're going to have dinner in a very shady restaurant.
I'm getting ready for
and
limited
run. He had this
run.
Big stack of paper with him. And on it was Baldur's Gate 3. And in it was pretty much everything that we talked about. And he says, I'm going to present this to my board. Do you still want to do it? I said, yeah. Of course, I still want to do it. And then a couple of weeks later, we started negotiating, and here we are.
I mean, what does the Baldur's Gate franchise mean to you, Mike?
Oh, to me, it's the crown jewel of D&D computer games, right? I mean, for me personally, Baldur's Gate, the original one, was the finally I had the chance to actually play a D&D campaign rather than having to run them for all my friends. So it just means so much to us. Baldur's Gate, it's, you know, such fantastic storytelling. And it's so exciting to see it come to not only a new generation of gamers, but for the gamers who remember the 20 years it's been since the original, the first two in the series. So it's incredibly exciting. And for us, it really is. It's such an important part of the D&D mythos as a whole.
And we got a chance to see the trailer. Talk to me about some of the story elements, the world elements. What are things we're going to see in Baldur's Gate 3?
Well, we're only talking about what's in the trailer right now, but obviously you're going to go to the city, because we start with the city. You start outside of the city, actually. Mm-hmm. There's going to be mind flayers. They're very nasty. You are seeing in the trailer the process of seromorphosis, as we call it. It's accelerated, so that's not normal.
Yeah.
And you're going to see a lot of iconic creatures, iconic characters, iconic places, and that's as far as we go.
Well, I'm curious about some of the gameplay elements, because obviously, you know, there's just been a big resurgence of Dungeons & Dragons, tons of broadcasts on Twitch. I mean, how do you translate some of the insane things that players want to do into, you know, what has to be a structured computer game?
So we started with the player handbook, which is basically the basic rule set of Dungeons & Dragons.
Which player handbook? Which edition?
Fifth edition.
Right. Yeah.
And so we ported as much as we could to the video game. We looked at what worked really well. We looked at the things that didn't work that well, because it is a video game, and this was made for tabletop gaming. And so we started modifying those things, and then we had to add things on top of it, because if you play tabletop, you have a game master, and you say, well, I want to do this.
Yeah.
And
then the game master... I want to start a fight with a pigeon. And he's like, okay, roll for dexterity.
Exactly. That's it. So we had to add systems to make that possible within the game. But we've gone very, very far.
Yeah, I mean, can you give an example of, like, a crazy moment that a player might do that you could actually play out in the game?
Well, I could, let's say that we get into a fight, because you ask a nasty question, I don't want to answer it. And I take the chair over there, I put it on fire, smash it on your head. Well, just as an example.
It's just an example, it's fine, we're just talking.
These are things that we have to put systems into the game for to do it, which are not necessarily going to be described inside of the book.
Interesting. And I mean, like, Mike, in terms of your role, speaking to Larian Studios, you have tons of data of all the things that players do. What's the sort of information that you provide in assistance?
Well, really what it comes down to is providing the story support. You know,
got
we think of Dungeons & Dragons, the universe
ready.
Of D&D. It's like a toy box for dungeon masters and players to go into.
They got 15 minutes before the next show starts to finish up.
Opening up that toy box and sharing it.
Hopefully
and
they
giving that
finish
kind of guidance.
Soon.
You know, like
I
remember one of our first meetings, we just laid out a map of Baldur's Gate and the Sword Coast and asking a lot of questions, like what kind of story do you want to tell? Where do we want to go? What are the cool locations we've always wanted to put into a game like this? And then in terms of the system support, you know, what does it mean in terms of the story for each character, for each character race, each character class? So that if you have your favorite class and it's in the game, you really feel like you're taking on that role that you love so much from the tabletop.
Yeah.
It's really coming to life in an authentic way in Baldur's Gate 3.
And we're going to talk in a moment about, you know, Baldur's Gate 3 release dates and whatnot, but we have a second game that we want to talk about on a new technology known as pencil and paper. I understand that there is a tabletop prequel coming for Baldur's Gate.
Exactly. So in Baldur's Gate, we think there's one saga, all the different games coming together to tell one grand story of this city. So on September 17th, we're releasing our next tabletop campaign, Baldur's Gate, Descent into Avernus, and it is the next chapter in the Baldur's Gate saga,
right.
And it's a prequel to Baldur's Gate 3. So if you haven't played a Baldur's Gate game since Baldur's Gate 1 or 2, this is your chance to check out on the history. It's been about 100 years since the events of Baldur's Gate 2.
Yeah.
So this will give you a chance to check in on the city, to see what's going on, its current state, who the movers and shakers are. We also feature a complete levels 1 to 13 campaign that takes you from the mean streets of Baldur's Gate to the depths of hell itself. And sort of pose to the players a question, do you want to redeem Baldur's Gate or send it to damnation? So we're putting that right in players' hands to make that choice.
Well, I have to ask, Sven, it's a question on a lot of people's minds. What can you talk to us about expected release timeframes?
So people have been waiting for it for a long time.
Yeah.
They're going to have to wait a little bit more when it's ready.
Oh, wow.
So this is the game that we want to play, so we want to make sure it's really, really good. And then when that's the case, then we'll release it.
Well, I know a lot of people have been waiting a long time, and I think I speak for a lot of people here when I say, take your time. If the Divinity Original Sin games are any indication of the quality, it's going to be fantastic and worth the wait. Gentlemen, thanks so much for joining me on stage.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Ben and Mike talking about Baldur's Gate 3. Goodbye. Goodbye, guys. Why are they leaving? Well, it's because the PC gaming show has officially concluded. Let's bring up on the stage the fantastic Frankie Ward. Come here, Frankie.
Hello. Well, thank you so much, Sean. Hasn't this audience been absolutely fantastic today?
Guys, thank you so much for coming out to the 5th annual PC Gaming Show. We want to give an enormous thanks to all of you who tuned in live. We want to, of course, thank all of you who personally showed up this morning, and of course, the sponsors who helped make this possible. Epic Game Store, iWin, Frontier, Funcom,
right, I'm going to start setting up for Hovercast, limited
Perfect
run
Rogue,
game.
Rebellion, Tripwire,
go into the
Samsung.
Be Right Back screen.
You know, PC gaming is a platform. It's not a
I'm not going off screen, but so I'll be here until that one starts, okay?
Thank you so much.
Listen to some music in the time being, and I'll be right back.
Well, I do love a baby elephant, so definitely Planet Zoo, and slightly more awkwardly, then I also want to eat things, maybe elephants included, so Maneater, of course.
I'm personally looking forward to Songs of Conquest, and as you heard, there's games coming out all across 2019 and into 2020.